You wouldn't be running numbers out of this club now, would you, son?
Running numbers is illegal, sir.
Running numbers without I know about it is both illegal and unhealthy. You remember that. Whoa, son, you're not finished. Pour his.
Well, I prefer it in the bottle.
Shut up, Hollis. How come you don't look familiar?
I've been away, up to Houston.
Houston? I hear they let you boys run wild up there. Oh, look what you've done now. Better get something to wipe it up, son.
You spilled it, maybe you should wipe it up.
I told you to do something. Are you gonna hop to it or are we gonna have a problem? You want to turn tail in front of your people, huh? I understand. Come on, Houston, give it a try. Come to Papa.
You are listening to TMBDOS. They must be destroyed on sight. The following podcast may contain adult language and discussions of an adult nature. Spoilers for the films discussed occur often. You have been warned. Now, take it away, Dr. Rausch.
They must be destroyed on sight!
Welcome back. It is They Must Be Destroyed on Sight, episode 207, and I am your host, Lee. Between nowhere and not much else, Russell, and I'm joined by my co-host, Daniel. Ain't had a good day since the Alamo, Harper. How you doing, sir?
I have not really had a good day since the Alamo, so yeah, no, that's all right, yeah.
I like your name, too, the Cold Winters Hypothesis.
We could talk about the cold winter hypothesis. This is something that I know quite a bit about.
Yeah, there's quite a few.
I forgot it was in this movie. I forgot it was in this movie, and yeah, no, a lot of themes here. Lots of we could actually do a commentary for this, I think. To talk about all the issues in it, and still not really cover everything. But I think we're not going to get to that level of depth. But you know,
I think the funniest thing is that, yet again, we did not plan for the subject matter of the movie we picked to necessarily be pretty much dead on with what's going on right now.
Right, you know. It's like, oh yeah, we did a couple of movies about how terrible cops are. Yeah, that's shitty. And then, you know, let's move on into a movie about, you know, John Sayles talking about immigration in Texas. That's not going to be politically interesting at all to the current era, you know.
We are doing Lone Star from 1996, but before we get into that, we do have a shit ton of comments to get through here, so we're going to try to do that. First off, from Darrow McAleese on our Facebook group says, I haven't posted for ages, has been buried in work with all that's been going on, but listening through all your current episodes from A Trip to the Moon to Wings, really digging this exploration and journey through early cinema. You guys are a lifeline in keeping my head sane as I work through a nightmarishly large report I need to complete. Totally agree with your comment about how your fellow podcasters love your digressions. I do too, as a movie fan. Your diversions into odd film categories is just my happy place. Keep up the good work, guys. And he also says, and I recently started putting some Patreon money your way, Daniel.
Yeah. Thank you. I did notice that, and you get nothing for that. That's the thing. My Patreon subscribers get nothing for their support except the happiness that comes from supporting me. So,
There you go.
Yeah. I have complicated reasons for that, you know, but, you know, ultimately, like, yeah. No, I have no time to do anything special for my Patreon subscribers at all. Just kind of goes out to the world. If you think I'm worth supporting, then support me. I thank you very much. You get nothing for it. $1, $50, $100, whatever.
You get the Gene Wilder treatment. You get nothing.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, no, thanks, Daro. Good to hear from you again. And yeah. Also, I want to throw it there. Jeff Williams, are you still fucking alive? Please leave a message on the old Facebook group if you are, because I haven't seen you post any suggestions. I haven't seen you post any reviews on your Letterboxd in the last couple months. So I'm just kind of wondering how you're doing. So
you think the pandemic got him?
I don't know. Maybe just it's keeping him busy. Maybe he's taking a break.
Yeah, no, I'm not. Sorry, I realized after I said that, like, you think he died of COVID-19, which, you know, would be a really depressing
or thought. Anything, honestly. Yeah, just wondering. So
I think the pandemic threw a lot of people into, like, kind of skipping their regular patterns of behavior. And so I'm hoping that as we just open up our economy and suddenly we're back to normal, despite the fact that we have no reason to do so, then people will just come back and join us again.
Yeah.
And describe all the terrible things that are happening in the reality. You know.
And now we got a bunch of comments on YouTube. All of them good. I decided, like, you know, fuck these fucking people.
There's no reason to read the shitty ones, ultimately, unless they're funny. If they're funny,
yeah, they haven't been. They've just been people from, like, Indonesia insulting me in their own language.
I know that your, like, strategy was to, like, read everything for a long time, and that meant, like, you know, give us the fucking movie, and all we do is just call these people shitheads, and they don't know.
Yeah,
and you know, the audience that listens to us, it probably enjoys us doing that, but, like, you know, almost probably not worth the time. You know, you could just be like, yeah, here's a list of four people who said, you know, give us the movie, and then just go, yeah, you're shitheads, and then just kind of move on.
Yeah.
So, you know, just read the interesting ones in the future. We are now to the point of which we get enough comments that we don't have to read them all.
That's the
philosophy.
So we have Peter Theobald, who's been commenting the last few weeks, sort of going through our YouTube versions of our episodes.
At first I thought you were going to say Peter Thiel, and I was going to laugh that, you know, billionaire, right-wing, shithead, Nazi tech guy is, like, commenting on our YouTube videos.
I don't think
Please continue.
Yeah, I don't think I'd want. Doesn't sound like a guy I'd want to like our podcast. No.
But, like, if he was listening, I would give him some messages, which would mostly be "Go fuck yourself" and "Stop being a Nazi" and "You destroyed journalism." You know, those would be three very easy things I would tell him. So, you know.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what the lesser Peter the something Peter Theobald said. Yeah.
Go ahead. Yeah. So on our Once Upon a Time in the West episode, he says, "I cannot really add anything to your account of this movie. It has made such an impression on me that nearly a decade after first viewing it in 69, that we called our daughter Jill at my request. Since then, I have probably watched it more times than the original Magnificent Seven." This is his favorite dialogue exchange. "Frank, I'm just a man. Harmonica, that's an ancient race." And he leaves it at that. Cool that you named your daughter Jill after the Jill in that movie. That's
a bit of a complicated thing if you've seen the movie, you know, but also amazing. I totally get that. Also, like, apparently Jill is, like, our age, because if he saw the film in 67 or 68 and then 10 years later, so we've got someone who, you know, like grandpa, you know, and, you know, Jill, that's pretty cool. That's actually, sorry, I was just kind of doing the math in my head and going, like, that's actually pretty awesome. So thank you.
Yeah.
He goes
on to our episode on In Old Arizona and The Virginian. This is most informative, boys. Watch The Virginian, and yes, it is sort of a screen test for Coop's later hit in High Noon over 20 years later. Also, I know now where Leone got the idea for his baby swapping scene in Once Upon a Time in America. And I think I saw, like, a chopped up version of that when I was a kid on TBS. I think I've never really actually watched. That's one of my movie nerd blind spots, I guess, where I've never actually watched that movie, like, full uncut on DVD kind of thing or whatever, you know. So
yeah, I've been saving Once Upon a Time in America for like one day I will sit down and watch it, but I have not seen it. So
yeah.
We should maybe make that like one of our, like, before the end of the year, like, just jump to it in December, just to Yeah, I think that'd be a good plan.
He goes on our Repo Man episode. And he says, another great review, boys. Excuse my use of the word boys, as I have a son who was born the same year as you, Daniel. As usual, I now have to revisit Repo Man after listening. Around the time of this movie, Alex Cox was presenting a weekly show for the BBC, introducing and showing some of his favorite cult films. I remember writing to him via the show for info on one of the many Italian westerns he presented. He kindly sent me an answer via postcard from Mexico. Holy shit.
This sounds like someone who should be on our podcast. Basically. Please come on. Give us an email address or something. We'd love to chat. Yeah.
Please do a skit on a show, I think is what he meant, on Walker, as this is another film that needs watching more than once. And yeah, that's Alex Cox. It is dressed in spaghetti Western dress, but it has much more to say than that. I'm about to now order a couple of DVDs under the joint title of Fear and Loathing in the Motor Trade. All right. Thank you, Peter. Keep commenting. Love to have those comments on our episode.
Join the Facebook group. We'd love to chat.
Yeah. And then we have one from ShadowMan4710 on our Platoon episode. And he says, I saw this when it came out, and like a lot of Oliver Stone's work, it really doesn't hold up all that well. I actually kind of agree with that with some stuff.
Yeah.
The thing that makes it is the acting from Berenger and Defoe, as well as some of the other supporting actors. Charlie Sheen as well. Charlie Sheen. I really can't take anything he does seriously anymore. Yeah, it is kind of hard.
And I think that was like one of his first, if not his first film. I know we kind of talked about that when we did the episode. You know, the same year he did Ferris Bueller's Day Off is sort of like the, you know, like the bad boy and, you know, flirting with Jennifer Grey Jennifer Grey. Long before he did even Major League. That's like 2 years before Major League.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of a major figure. Major League would be a film that we should do at some point when we want to just poke fun at racism. That would be the reason to do it. A film I grew up with that I watched a little bit of like a few years ago and went like, oh, I forgot how terribly racist this was. I mean, you know, the thing with Platoon is it's early in Stone's career. It's a very personal film for Stone. It is dated, but it's dated in the way that like anything from 1986 just kind of is, you know. And Stone himself like far outgrew that kind of cinematic technique. And yet it has very real qualities that are make it worth seeing. And so I don't feel like it's dated so much as like for its time. You know what I mean? I feel like there's a difference. Yeah. But and that's not to argue with our commenter as much as it is to sort of like clarify my own feelings about that.
Although I think we both thought that held up pretty well, though. Like that.
Absolutely.
I think I said it on the episode. That's pretty much still the best Vietnam film that's been made, pretty much. Like,
I mean, you know, it's certainly in that, like, kind of top tier. Like, you know. And in fact, I remember if you look at, like, Roger Ebert's review of, like, Full Metal Jacket, which is released in 87, like, he explicitly says, like, Kubrick is brilliant. But, like, you can't watch this, which is made clearly on a soundstage in England, you know, and compare it to Platoon and think this is of any value whatsoever. Like, it just doesn't look the same at all, you know. Like, Stone being a filmmaker who served in Vietnam, who came back, who literally learned filmmaking as a way of kind of talking about his experiences to some degree. And then eventually got to make this film, and this being kind of very early in his career, and now he's gone on to be this kind of like other figure, but at the same time, like someone who was there at the time. I mean, it's probably the most authentic kind of Vietnam film we're ever going to get.
Yeah.
Despite its kind of genre tropes and despite like kind of the problems that we had with it, you know?
Yeah.
I think one of the things is, I think we did criticize Charlie Sheen's performance mostly as, you know, you just don't feel like you're quite in that moment. And we were really going to do that with Casualties of War. And I think Michael J. Fox in Casualties of War is much more kind of fills that same role. So you almost wish Fox had been like cast in that, which would have been a year after Back to the Future.
Yeah.
That movie would have made even more money. I think if, because Back to the Future was the top grossing film of 85. So, you know, I think he was still doing like yuppie roles in like Secret of My Success and Alex P. Keaton at that point, though. So, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, that's kind of what the Charlie Sheen character is, really. That's his, kind of his background in that movie. So, yeah, so we're going to take a quick break. We're going to play a little bit of music from the excellent fucking soundtrack of Lone Star and some podcast promos, and we'll be back to talk about Lone Star.
Did you ever see a film at such a young age it left you traumatized with cinematic wounds?
Necrophilia.
It's a dead issue, man. Don't push it. Cinema Psyops is a weekly podcast documenting an ongoing experiment on the mind of an unwilling test subject.
No one should have to watch this movie.
Oh, no one should have to watch this.
No one should have to watch this movie.
Surprisingly, it's not a topic that a lot of people really want to tackle.
I'm shocked, prudes.
I know, really.
Right?
It's the next sexual frontier that no one wants to explore.
I am, in the most sincerest of senses, disappointed in you.
It takes a powerful goddess like Connie, jam her arm down the monster's throat and kill it. I'm still tripping out over that. Even as a kid, I was like, I gotta find a girl like that.
Every week, I get a new look of disappointment that I never thought I could get out of
it. It's unimaginable. At 12 years old, you should not be watching this movie.
Obviously.
At 13, you should not be. 14, you shouldn't be. I'm not entirely sure even 17-year-olds should be watching this movie.
Just because you're offended by something doesn't mean that you have the right to demand that it doesn't exist. Watching this film again, I had all of this like little nerd glee with everything that kept popping up.
Little history doll popping up at you.
So I totally loved this film.
Hey, I know why you know, couldn't see that. It's because your brain's warped watching this shit at 12 years old.
Yeah, this is a rough movie. I told you ahead of time when we were getting ready to do it that it was going to be a rough
movie. How did you watch this shit at 12?
Because physical wounds heal, cinematic ones don't. Listen to Cinema Psyops.
Rio Grande, strolling with my lover, hand
All right, Lone Star from 1996.
Years ago, under Sheriff Charlie Wade, Rio County was as corrupt as they came.
That Sheriff Wade, he could get ugly.
Then, Buddy Deed showed up.
How about you lay that shield on this table and vanish?
You're a dead man.
They called him a legend.
He was a unique individual.
They called him a champion of justice.
The day that man died, they broke the damn mold.
His son is about to find out the truth.
Follow me.
I'm Sheriff Deed.
Sheriff Deed is dead, honey. He's just Sheriff Junior.
We found a body out by Fort McKenzie yesterday. You got any idea who might have put him there?
A hell of a time to bring up old business.
That badge
didn't come out of a cereal box.
Start digging holes in this county, no telling what will come up.
You two saw it, didn't you? I'm gonna find out one way or the other.
I just think people in town ought to know the full story on Buddy Deeds.
That makes two of us.
Castle Rock Entertainment presents the new film from acclaimed director John Sayles.
You gotta be careful where you go poking. Who knows what you'll find?
Lone Star.
Directed and written by John Sayles. And is starring Kris Kristofferson as Charlie Wade, Matthew McConaughey as Buddy Deeds, Chris Cooper as Sam Deeds, Elizabeth Pena as Pilar Cruz, Miriam Colon as Mercedes Cruz, Clifton James as Hollis Pogue, Jeff Monahan as young Hollis Pogue, Ron Canada as Otis Payne, Gabriel Cassis as young Otis Payne, Joe Morton as Delmore Payne, Eddie Robinson as Chet Payne, and Frances McDormand in a kind of just a small cameo role, really, as Bunny, but quite the role, actually.
A very good role. Again, the same year as Fargo, so I like to think that she kind of just like transitioned between these two things, like in a day, like you know, she's doing Fargo and then going off and being like, you know, I'm gonna be like Fry from Futurama's mom for an hour.
Shit, yeah, that's pretty spot on. So, synopsis here from someone called John Reeves on IMDb. When the skeleton of his murdered predecessor is found, Sheriff Sam Deeds unearths many other long-buried secrets in his Texas border town. And yeah, that's the bare minimum. That's, you know, that's the back of the box kind of thing. But that is kind of what happens. I mean, it's not like there's a lot of plot in this necessarily.
I mean, there's a lot that happens here, yeah. Right? There's a lot of backstory, and I think part of the should we just dive into it? I think that it's very easy for a first time viewer to kind of walk away from this and going like, I don't really quite know what, especially if you're just kind of watching it casually, because you do kind of have to understand that there are kind of three, it's not even plot lines, but three characters that we're kind of paying attention to. And they each have a backstory to their sort of like father. So it's very much about kind of fathers and sons in this border town. And there's also a sort of a mystery which drives the plot and sort of gives us sort of the like the basic mechanism by which this thing goes on. But the plot really isn't that important in the, you know, like the mystery is there. It's sort of interesting. It's not like a terrible story, but ultimately it's a 15 minute plot. If you're just kind of talking about the murder mystery, it's ultimately about sort of the things that are sort of unearthed as we sort of like explore this murder mystery in terms of sort of the characters and their connections between each other and the sort of kind of psychic provenance of, you know, father, really the sense of the fathers being visited upon sons. And then those sons have become fathers who have their own kind of issues that kind of move forward. And it's sort of like, I mean, I think John Sayles is a filmmaker, and I am not like super familiar with John Sayles.
Me either.
I really love Men with Guns. I think that's a really great film, which equally, I mean, that's a film that's about sort of Mexico and like, you know, sort of the impact of sort of American colonialism and sort of Western imperialist power and, you know, kind of dictatorship within, you know, kind of Latin America, et cetera, et cetera. And the way that Western power inflicts the indigenous population. So in a way, that film is like even more, and that's only 2 years after this one. And so in a way, it was about sort of you know, the same kind of general themes that are kind of going on here, but at an even lower economic strata in a way, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And in that sense, I'm sorry, we were just kind of talking about Oliver Stone, ironically. Oliver Stone and John Sayles are kind of the only American filmmakers who have any kind of sense of exploring sort of the impact of, you know, sort of American imperialism in the world and this kind of sense of what colonization does and what kind of like big picture. I mean, Sayles more so than Stone. Stone is about kind of like the kind of very much about like, let's talk about what how bad bombing Cambodia was. Whereas Sayles is more about like, let's talk about how these sorts of patterns of repression and patterns of oppression are, you know, kind of play themselves out in sort of the modern day world. And so we get scenes of, you know, we're in this border town with a large, you know, Mexican-American population.
Yeah.
And they have a very different sense of like what the Alamo means than the sort of white historically, quote unquote, American.
We have a PTA meeting basically with a Karen in here going, they're destroying our heritage by tearing down our whatever, you know, like.
It's very of this like particular moment in 2020. Right. But of course, like in the mid 90s, you know, this was at the height of kind of the textbook wars. This was kind of the beginning of like doing revisionist textbooks was the 90s. And I remember because like I studied out of some of those textbooks in the United States, you know, although being in public school in Alabama in the 90s was basically, go fuck yourself is the war of Southern aggression, you know, or the war of North aggression, you know, which isn't quite true. I can't even remember if they ever called it that, but it was very much like there were little things of like, well, actually, the slave owners were very kind to the slaves, et cetera.
Yeah, it was more like indentured servitude than it was actual slavery.
Well, I mean, it was slavery and it was bad and we feel bad about that. But also, like, don't you think the slave owners get kind of a bad rap?
Yeah, someone had to pick that cotton. And look how well the Negro has done for himself now that he's pulled himself up by the bootstraps and got religion. Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
But yeah, no. And so it's funny, like, looking at this 24 years later, and kind of going like, we're kind of still having the same debates. I mean, this film feels very much of its moment in a lot of ways. I mean, Matthew McConaughey in a supporting role, you know, at the very beginning of his career.
You know?
And yet, you know, it feels very kind of the current moment as well, in the sense of we're still talking about the same fucking things, you know. Also, I just want to highlight this here. Elizabeth Pena, I fucking love Elizabeth Pena. I think most people will know her from Rush Hour,
right?
Probably before anything else. And it's kind of a shame that she died a few years ago.
Yeah, it was 2014. She died, right? Corrosive of the liver or something like that.
I kind of get the feeling she was a horrifying alcoholic.
That's kind of the impression I get, which is just it's so heartbreaking because she's so good, and even just on a surface level, that fucking voice, she's so sexy.
Oh yeah,
yeah. Even when she's just like saying like standard lines of dialogue, like take the dog out. Wow, sexy as fuck. Like
absolutely. Yeah,
who let the dogs out? Elizabeth Pena did, man.
Pena let the dogs out for sure. Mm-hmm. I don't know. There is a, you know, we get the murder mystery, the kind of the Western murder mystery
plot. It's it's kind of neo-noir and Western all sort of wrapped up in the one. And you're right, it's a very slight plot, but it's decidedly, you know, like constructed that way because it's not really about the murder of Kris Kristofferson's character.
Charlie Wade. The person, like the sheriff before Buddy Deeds, who is Matthew McConaughey's character, who is Chris Cooper's dad. And so you get, originally when you're first kind of introduced to this, you kind of get the sense of, like, well, he's a terrible guy, and totally he was killed by Matthew McConaughey. He was killed by Buddy Deeds. And that isn't really what happens, but it's kind of what happens at the, you know.
It's what was going to happen.
Right. But it's also like, you know, we sort of get this sense of we're sort of following the logic of the mystery, sort of following it just in terms of like interviewing witnesses, which really kind of give us, yes, you get the detail of, you know, whatever in that scene. Oh, this is the thing that was happening. But it's really about sort of like feeding in details about the world that these characters live in, which is increasingly the world in which we live, because it's really about sort of the implicit and explicit racism, and about sort of these like complicated racial relations among the people. And that's like, you learn that Buddy Deeds, Matthew McConaughey's character, was very much a friend. Like, he was a good cop. You know, he was very much a friend to the African American community, but absolutely kind of fucking hated Mexicans, you know? The fact that, like, apparently, I mean, at least we're told by a possibly unreliable narrator that, yeah, there, you know, even the Mexican families in the town, you know, as long as they weren't illegal, they were kind of treated fairly by Buddy Deeds. But at the same time, Chris Cooper, Sam Deeds, who was Buddy Deeds' son, really fucking hated his father, but for like personal reasons, you know? And so you get this kind of like really uneasy, kind of complicated sense of kind of who these people are, right?
You get a sense that, so the biggest sort of thing hang, like the sword sort of hanging over this whole thing, is whether or not Buddy Deeds was actually a murderer, and what that will do to the town if that comes out. And you do learn, and I'm just gonna say spoilers. Like, if you haven't watched the movie before we start talking about it, you need to go watch it and come back. Right. Okay,
I feel like you will get a lot of the film even if you know the ending. Like,
I don't want to spoil it for anybody, because
sure, it's worth. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
we're good. But so you learn that Buddy Deeds ultimately is not a murderer. But you do sort of learn with the conversations that Chris Cooper has with all the people in town and the old people who were around when Buddy Deeds was around and when Wade was around. You learn that he sort of was a real politician as a cop. Like, he very much intertwined with the politics of the town. And he definitely made a lot of things better for people. But at the same time, you know, he still kind of played hardball and, you know, definitely held some people down to get things done. You know, you hear the story he has with the janitor at the jailhouse, who was in jail for a period of time, and Buddy Deeds, you know, would let him out of jail to build his deck for him during the summer, you know? And so that sort of thing. And what the interesting thing is, you get the perspective of the different people from the different cultures and the different social standings within those cultures. And they all remember things differently. They all have a different perspective on what Buddy Deeds actually meant to them.
Yeah, there's a bit of a Citizen Kane effect here. You
know? Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think it's just so well constructed. Like, you get such a great sense of this town. And even though it doesn't, I don't feel like it hammers you over the head with any of its points it's making. Like, I just feel it very naturally comes out of the performances of the characters, that you just get a feel for this town. You get a feel of the politics, you get a feel of the race relations, and it doesn't necessarily try to, like, become a big message movie and, like, smash you over the head with anything,
there is a kind of clear political message, which is, you know, life is shit, things are really complicated, racism is bad, etc. Yep. You know what I mean? You know, like,
yeah.
But, like, it's not making a sort of, like, it's not saying, like, you know, we need to expand immigration. Although I think the film is clearly arguing that, you know, immigration controls on borders are bad. You know, like
the conversation he has with the dude in Mexico there, where the guy draws a line in the sand with the Coke bottles, like, step over that, you know,
right.
I don't have to answer any of your questions because of this bullshit border right here. You know, that, right, the, right. You know,
and I mean, there was a Supreme Court case a few years ago where there was some kid playing around the fence of the border wall. Kids play around that fence who live near it all the fucking time, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the fence is like some like meters on the inside of the U.S.-Mexico border, right? You know?
Okay, yeah.
So there's some percentage, like there's some like 20 feet or whatever of behind the border wall that is U.S. territory, right? And so like, some kid was like throwing rocks at a border patrol agent. And then this border patrol agent just opened fucking fire at these fucking kids and killed one of them. And the Supreme Court decides, because the kid happened to be just over the border, like there's a gully, and it, like, based on the placement of the gully, they determined, like, he's actually over the Mexico border. Based on this, like, it turns out that the kid doesn't even get to sue because of, like, you know, fucking bullshit legal arrangements. And this is part and parcel. It's the sort of thing that is, this is the reality of the situation in which there are these, like, communities, Mexican people, people who live in Mexico, and Americans who are very ethnically similar, despite the fact that, like, sort of the, there's a more kind of white Anglo, you know, percentage on the American right. side of the border for obvious reasons, but, like, very culturally similar. I think it divided by this, like, kind of like false border wall, right?
Yeah.
Which is enforced by, you know, U.S. imperialist policy. 100 years ago in 1920, you could cross that border with no problems. There was no question about your ability to cross that border. You could just kind of show up and, you know, start a ranch, or you could, you know, have, you know, and you would have been you wouldn't have been seen as fully a citizen or whatever, but you could definitely kind of be, like, naturalized. And, like, increasingly as the value of labor started to change, and, you know, then suddenly we started to militarize that border. And I mean, it's disgusting. It's bullshit. And this film doesn't really get into that. It doesn't kind of get far back, but certainly, like, it's on its mind. That these kinds of concepts of there is this kind of politicized border here. There is a kind of a Mexican side, their Mexico side, and a U.S. side. You know, this does sort of play into those same general ideas. In a way, I'd want to see this as a kind of a companion piece to Touch of Evil, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of similarly about, like, the same kind of idea, although it's set on the other side of the border.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you think about, okay, so the film is made in 1996, and they're talking about, like, 40 years earlier. They're talking about 1957, and Touch of Evil is made in 1958. And you'd kind of imagine that this is sort of on the mind of John Sayles when he's sort of, like, designing the film. That, like,
Charlton Heston is Buddy Deeds. And
there's a very real, I mean, in a sense, this is a film in dialogue with Touch mm-hmm. of Evil. And I think, you know, I think you and I could argue about this. I think Touch of Evil is on sort of the second tier of Wells films. I don't think that it's quite on that, like, sort of
depends on what version you watch.
I think I have only ever seen the good version, the quote unquote the good version mm-hmm. of Touch. I think I put it on the second tier just because I deeply love, like, I mean, you know, I don't think, like, directorially, I think it's among his best. I think narratively and in terms of kind of what it's doing, I'm not sure I'd kind of put it right up there with
it,
and it's best to be like Citizen Kane, F for Fake.
Okay, yeah, it doesn't deeply go into the stuff as Sayles does here. I'll give you that. It's much more interested in the sort of noir,
right?
Sort of mechanics and stuff. Yeah.
I mean, you know, like, second tier Wells is, like, better than, like, 9.9% of horror. You know, it's not like damning it with faint praise or anything like that. I mean, I'm just saying, like, you know, despite the fact that I don't think it's, like, among the, like, very best of what Wells is doing, I think it really would work as kind of a double bill with Lone Star. And I think that speaks very highly of Lone Star, honestly.
Yeah, no, and I mean, with Wells, it's like, it's really splitting hairs. It's like, you got top tier Wells, and then you got, like, Wells slumming it in a movie for money. Like, that's kind of the demarcation line there. Like, kind of, you know,
I'm only considering his directorial, like, his writer director work, as opposed to, like, I mean, he was in a bunch of shit, but that, you know, like, we're not considering Transformers the movie, and that's, like, you know, consideration there, you know.
You don't
Touch of Evil, two steps above Transformers the movie. It's kind of what
you don't care about the racial politics between the Decepticons and the Autobots, and how Unicron is the over encroaching greed and hubris of. I'm going to stop right there. I was trying to make something up, but, you know.
Yeah, I haven't seen that film since I was a kid, so
I'm not going to apologize for that film, because it crushed my childhood when it killed all the, like, cool Autobots in the first scene. Yeah,
fair. Actually, the bread tuber H. Marmer guy had a very nice video about how when he first saw Transformers the movie, and how it's sort of like the sort of the politics of it and everything. So you know, worth watching. Yeah. I watched the film again for 35 years, but
yeah. Yeah. So I do find it interesting. Like, this town is in a transitional phase. Chris Cooper's character, he he was estranged from his father basically for so many years, and he comes back after a messy divorce. He's basically just propped up as a figurehead because he's got the deed's name by, you know, the white establishment, who is, and the whites are the minorities in this town, actually.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they say many times that the Hispanics are like 90% of the population of this town, you know.
So they know
that. But the fact that the film doesn't really show us that.
Right. Right.
You know.
But I mean, still, if you know, and they make a mention of this, that the next sheriff is definitely going to be Mexican,
yeah.
You know, like he's going to be of that heritage. And it's interesting. You see the one guy who's gunning for the job. He comes up to Chris Cooper. And is like, I just wanted to let you know, I'm going to be running as sheriff. And Chris Cooper asks him, so, okay, so what's your opinion on this? And he's just like, well, you know, there's good people on both sides, basically, is his answer. You
right,
know?
Right. And you know, playing the political game,
yeah.
which is, I mean, I think a very, like, kind of realistic, I don't know, we talked a lot about, like, Greg Daniels in the last couple of episodes, and I feel like there's a very kind of, like, Greg Daniels is very interested in sort of, like, local politics and, like, sort of, like, the way that, you know, you can be kind of intimately connected to someone, and then you sort of like play the political game. Mm-hmm. And I think this film, like, I'm trying to like praise it by saying it really does it just as well by saying, like, you know, oh, well, what do you think about such and such? It's like, well, you know, we have, and it's the naming, I think it's the naming of the town hall.
No, it's the fact that one of these big fucking prisons is coming in, you know, and, right. And basically, I think it's
no. They're adding capacity to the jail.
Well, no, so they're building a prison on the land that they find Wade's body on. They're building a new prison.
God, is that, you've seen this more than I am. So
there's talk that jobs are going to be gone, like something, like some sort of industry is leaving the town.
So the military base is supposedly leaving the town.
Yeah.
Going to leave, you know, like the entire economy is going to be ripped out because, like, essentially, this is a border town. It's meant, like, basically the service industry that gives alcohol and blowjobs to soldiers is the, you know, is all this town is there for, you know, like,
yeah. Yeah.
And so this the base is leaving, and we should talk about the military base.
Oh yeah,
well, yeah. But so the base is leaving. They're trying to kind of figure out what to do in the meantime, and so I guess they're kind of putting in this kind of big prison. They're kind of increasing the jail capacity. Deeds is like, yeah, no, we have plenty of capacity. We don't need any more jail space. And that's, you're right. He asks, like, he asked the Hispanic guy, like, you know, what do you think about this? I was like, well, you know, this is a conversation with a lot of nuance. We really have to think about all the sides of this conversation. And the guy totally knows, yeah, we don't need this, but it's going to bring it. We're going to get a bunch of money for this, and they're going to support my campaign. And so suddenly, like, I have to play ball with them.
And everybody in town's going to be working for the prison, you know, within a couple of generations.
Which is exactly what happens in a lot of these small towns. You put a big prison in, and suddenly, you know, half the population is guarding the other half.
Yep.
The prison industrial complex, things that I have no opinion about whatsoever.
Yeah.
My leftist, my SJW cut boy.
Man, there's so much in this movie.
Yeah.
Fucking...
We should talk about Joe Morton. Can we talk about Joe Morton?
Yeah, let's do it.
He's great. Done. Mm-hmm. Okay. Moving on. No. Joe Morton, who has a Delmore Payne, and I think most... If you're my age, you probably remember him as from Terminator 2.
Yep.
But he's been in a bunch of stuff, and he is the. So this is where, like, the film kind of like leans into its the premise, just sort of. The film sort of leans into a coincidence just a little bit, you know, for me, mm-hmm. in terms of, like, it sets up its plot by saying, "Well, Buddy Deeds is now the he was away for a long time." And now he's, or pardon me, Sam Deeds. He was away for a long time, and now he's back, and he's the sheriff. And also Elizabeth Pena, Pilar Cruz, she's still hanging out in town because she's super hot, and her mom owns the restaurant, and she's a school teacher now. And also, like, the other guy, Joe Morton, Payne's kid, he is just magically back here to shut down this military base. And so all these people who have no reason to be living in this tiny town are now back living in this tiny town just when they discover this body. And so there is a sort of like plot coincidence kind of thing going on. And you just have to kind of paper over that and just accept it as like a thing, you know? It's also like, you know, one of the things that I think we think about when we watch this film for the first time is there's a lot of people and a lot of names that get dropped and there's a lot of stuff. Right. And it's really easy to kind of lose track of who's who and what exactly is kind of going on without having kind of like a cast list of Wikipedia open. So it does help to watch this two or three times to really kind of get at the, you know, kind of
I will say, like, I think the movie does a good job of, like, holding your hand with this, though, because both through the actual casting of the younger counterparts of our main characters, which is some of the best I've ever seen in a movie. Like, these people, spot on look like the people you see the older versions of in the present.
I mean, today they would do it digitally. They would just de-age the actors, and it would not... I mean, it would not look very different than what we see in this film because they really did like find actors that, you know, look very, very, very similar.
And the other thing is just the smoothness of Sayles' transitions here between flashbacks and the present, which is it's all within the same shot and it's just fucking great. Like the way he does it, it's
very, very, very kind of Wellesian. If you know where I'm going at, like where he like, pans down and it's like, you know, it all started with a bowl of tortillas and then like you pan down and then over to a bowl of tortillas and then like a hand reaches in and it's like, there we are, we're back in the past. Like this is a very, you know, you could see this being a very, you know, again, a very touch of evil kind of cut, you know? Joe Morton, someone who I've really liked since I was a kid, I really enjoy his performance, who's sort of this like hard ass, colonel, I guess, who's kind of running this military base, which is in the process of being shut down. And he's like, I'm not giving up anything for, you know, like we're going to be hard ass until the very end. Yeah. And there's a shooting of a soldier at one of these bars. And it turns out that his own son was hanging out in that bar at that night. And the guy running the bar is like, yeah, you weren't here. You need to go at the back. It's, you know, don't talk to anybody. You were definitely not here. But the sort of investigation reveals this, you know, the film is about this sort of like complicated relationship that people have with their own kind of place within the army, right? You know, because, you know, you've got this young woman who's, you know, I joined to have a career. I joined, you know, it's my job to fight because you white people aren't going to do it for me, you know. She's like, yeah, I used to date this, like, deadbeat dickhead who kind of went in and did this shooting, but, like, that's not on me, and it's not anything, you know. There is this tension between kind of two of the officers who end up dating, you know, to learn they're like fucking around for themselves. And this whole like, again, this whole like complexity in terms of, you know, we have our kind of official positions where we have to sort of like behave in a certain way, but also we know that there's kind of more kind of going on behind that. And I feel like this tension between sort of the public and private persona kind of like wraps around this film over and over again. Like, kind of get this sense constantly in terms of, well, there are things that like are between me and you in our bedroom, and then there are things that kind of like the version of ourselves that we portray to the rest of the world, and like that history itself is sort of like built around the same interactions. And you know, when we do revise history, we do kind of look back and go like, well, actually, it turns out that guy committed a genocide. He might have been a pretty, you know, I think about like Ulysses S. Grant, right? There were some like statues of Ulysses S. Grant that were like torn down. And there was this big kind of thing of, but he crushed the Klan when he was president. That's true. He also genocided the Native Americans. So, you know, we get to, you know, it's a complicated legacy. It is. Mm-hmm. And we get to have a conversation about it. Doesn't mean he gets to have a statue.
Exactly. Yeah. And should mention that, Joe Morton here, his character, his dad is his biological father, not necessarily his dad, his biological father who ran out on him as a kid is the one who is running this bar that the shooting happens in. And there's a tension between those two because, you know, secretly from afar, he sort of learns through like his dad's current wife, who is a womanizer, who's had many, she even mentions, like, yeah, he's had quite a few before me, you know, kind of thing. It's like, yeah. But she's cool with it. Like, she's, yeah, no, I know who I am. I know what this relationship is. And, you know, we're doing the thing. And, but he learns.
One of my favorite characters is, like, Mrs. Bledsoe, who is sitting on the front
with
porch.
With the Game Boy.
You know?
Yeah. You ever play one of these things?
You ever play one of these things? I always say I'm going to have my breakfast and play three games, and now I've been here half the day.
Yeah, it's a great scene. And he has another great line too, because he's like, "I'm Sheriff Deeds." It's like, "No, you're Sheriff Junior. Sheriff Deeds is dead.
Sheriff Deeds is dead." And he's like, "Oh, fair enough."
Yeah, I hear that all the time.
Yeah, I hear that all the time. Yeah.
But
it's funny how much, like, the first half of the film was, like, filled with that stuff before you really, like, kind of dig into the plot. And then, like, the second half is kind of more like, and now we kind of got to get things moving. And I feel like the first half, I definitely like the first half more than the second half.
Yeah. You get to just hang out with the characters more and learn what they're about, right? But yeah, so Joe Morton's character, you know, he has conflict with his estranged biological father, but he learns that, you know, he's secretly been proud of him, like, all these years. He has this, like, shrine to him, basically, of all his newspaper clippings, because he's got this whole hobby of Seminole Indian heritage kind of thing, and they're actually blood connected to Seminole Indians.
Right. There's some Native American, I mean, sort of multiracialism gets kind of played up over and over again in the film in terms of, like, there are big questions of identity and, like, who are you exactly? And,
yeah, it's one of those things which is, like, there's all the different characters that are sort of followed in here. They're sort of individual stories, all could have made a pretty decent movie on their own, but they're still kind of, like, interwoven in here and handled really well. Like, I was pretty satisfied with sort of everything that happened here in all these. There's a bridge sort of built between Morton and his father. You know, also sort of between how he treats his son too. Like, his son sort of feels like he has the expectation that, I have to join the army because my dad's a hard ass. And he kind of, in Joe Morton's character, he sort of learns through, going over the review of this young woman who was involved in this shooting thing, you know what? Maybe I need to lighten up a little bit. Like, people are.
Well, when he comes to his son and says, like, if it's not for you, it's not for you.
Yeah.
Like, he has dreams for his son, and clearly, like, he's never questioned those. And his son is even like, well, I'm totally going to have to do this. And you can kind of tell he's kind of fucking off in class in part because, you know, he's got no option. I said, "Well, I'm going to go to West Point."
He's getting a B average, and in the early scene, his father's like, "You think West Point's going to take a B average? You got to do better, son." And, you know, it's like,
well, it's like, and the answer is like, "Well, yeah, but you're my dad."
Yeah,
I mean, you know, frankly, you know, I think I'm going to be fine. But yeah, no, I like that there is this kind of complicated, and you get this kind of over and over again, and this is something that, you know, I've only seen this film twice now, and I actually bought the like digital version on YouTube. You know, it was like $5 on YouTube, and I'm like, yeah, I'll do that, that's fine. I'm probably gonna be revisiting this, you know, over the course of the next, you know, couple of years, and just sort of put it on and really kind of luxuriate in it, because I feel like I don't quite get some of the connections that the film is trying to make. And there's you kind of get this idea of, like, there's this sort of like the natural cut where, like, within a scene, you know, you're doing coverage, and then, like, the storyteller cut of, like, we're cutting between sequences. And there are these, like, kind of three families, these three kind of central characters or ideas that we're sort of, like, cutting between. And I feel like there are, like, parallelisms between them that I just haven't quite unearthed in terms of kind of my impression of the film. But I think the film is, like, ultimately, it's very, I mean, even on a, even kind of a superficial level, even if you don't necessarily kind of follow everything that's going on all the time, because I do think that the film kind of suffers from just sort of, like, it's a lot of things happening, and if you're not completely up on which name is whose, then it's very easy to get lost. Even if you're not kind of, like, up on that, I think the film is very entertaining and really interesting in terms of kind of its ideas. And my kind of issue at this point of, like, again, only having seen it twice is kind of not necessarily feeling like I have like a complete handle on like what the film is really trying to say about these kind of like three different characters. And I feel like there are connections that I'm missing between like some of the like sideline people. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense.
Yeah. Spoil like the sort of big, the big reveal here is that we learn that Chris Cooper and Elizabeth Pena's characters, who were in love as kids, and that relationship got broken up by Chris Cooper's dad, Buddy Deeds. And that's why he's had that estrangement from him ever since, basically, is because he hated him for that. And we come to learn that Buddy Deeds was sticking it to Elizabeth Pena's mom, and that they're actually half brother, half sister.
Yeah. And they're just going to go like, well, I guess we're just going to keep fucking.
Yeah. We love each other anyway. So who gives a fuck, you know,
kind of thing. We're not going to have any kids. It's going to be fine.
Yeah. So,
I find it interesting that we never meet the adult Buddy Deeds. Like it is kind of one of those things that like, typically you would at least see like photographs or you get like some scene of kind of him being like a shit to like kind of the child, Sam Deeds character or something like that. But really you kind of learn of Buddy Deeds from the legend and you get like very brief sequences of Matthew McConaughey kind of being a badass and like in the 50s, you know?
Yeah. Very, there's very much like this big mythology built up around him and, Chris Christopherson's Wade character too.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, we should probably talk about Chris Christopherson as well.
Fucking one of the best laid-back monsters I've ever seen on film. Like, he's so psychopathic and evil, but at the same time, is like, he never like really gets mad. Like, he's very laid-back, and he's looking at everybody like they're fucking meat for him to chew on, you know, kind of thing.
Well, he's the big dick in town, he knows he's the big dick in town, and like, he gets to just kind of do whatever he wants. And
he's a crime boss, basically.
Yeah, exactly, and that's, which is, you know, what the cops are.
Yeah,
like it's you know, again, very very Orson Welles in touch with you. But yeah, no, the thing that I love about the film is the racism. I do admire, as someone who is a bit of a student of modern day racism, there's a lot of really sophisticated racism going on here. It describes it. I mean, we talked about sort of the textbook committee and sort of the way that they're kind of talking about things and going like, look, this is our side of the border, and that's the, you know, and you may have your own version of the Alamo, but this is our version of the Alamo, and it's our place, and we get to tell it kind of our way, which isn't what anyone should be saying, but it's very much an argument that people will make regardless. It's like, well, these are our heroes, and this is how we, you know, we keep our statues, we keep our schools the way we want them. Dante, we mentioned the cold winters hypothesis, which I completely forgotten was in this movie. And it's like, you know, I'm as liberal as the next guy. I'm just saying, like, you know, when you live in the northern hemisphere, you live cold places, you gotta like build silos to store grain as opposed to like
kickstarts your brain instead of sitting on a beach waiting for fish to jump up on it, you know?
And not to spoiler alert, this idea was is currently a thing, but was central to the theories of a man named Fritz Lenz. Fritz Lenz, the scientific authority that was quoted in terms of the building of the Nuremberg Laws and was one of the ideological architects of the Holocaust.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert. Yeah.
So go figure with that one.
no, very much, and it's still used today. Can I tell you, like, my favorite piece of scientific bullshit in defense of anything ever? Which is, there was a paper that was published in defense of this idea. Like, not even like in like 1965. This is like 2009 or whatever. I don't have the citation ahead of me, but this is like recent, like within the last like 10 or 15 years. And this group of researchers, quote unquote, built a whole paper around like kind of defending this hypothesis. And they had these very sophisticated mathematical models. They had a bunch of data. They plugged in, the data was mostly bullshit, but that's because all this data is mostly bullshit. Like, who knew? In their analysis, it turns out that they were completely wrong, because they were measuring the distance from sort of the like a human race's origination port
point in Central Africa, and sort of like measuring the distance based on, and then like sort of like sophistication of like IQ or whatever. And it turned out that they neglected to account for the existence of oceans in sort of their measurement of distance. And so they were just measuring like straight line values, you know?
Jesus Christ.
The paper is still cited today by fucking bullshit racists. So, you know.
Yeah, of course it is. Of course.
Anyway, by which to say, like, I include that here because I think it's very funny, first of all. And B, I think it does describe the degree to which Sayles and his other, like, kind of the writers and the producers were very familiar with sort of the way that racism really manifests. Like, it has felt, as someone, again, who has studied to American racism to an absurd degree, this felt very, very authentic to me. There was something, there's something in almost every scene that really kind of goes,
well, there's,
this is how racists talk. This is not, you know, kind of.
There's even racism just within the actual cultures themselves.
Yeah.
So, you know, you got the Elizabeth Pena's mother, who is running the restaurant, who's this respectable, you know, a Mexican woman who's yeah. made her empire basically in America. She calling border patrol on illegal immigrants coming in yeah. across the border. You know, she gets involved in the situation with one of her employees who's actually running, you know, people across the border. And he, you know, explains the situation. You know, this woman with us, she slipped, she broke her leg. We need to get her medical help. And if you call the border patrol, you know, we'll all be fucked. And she's like, typical, you know, she's just like typical Mexicans, you know, those people across the border, that kind of talk, you know, where it becomes normalized.
Absolutely. And yeah. you know, because you gain access to a certain amount of capital, you gain access to a certain amount of respectability. And suddenly, you know, you have a very different opinion. And certainly, like, well, I jumped through the hoops and I did this the right way and I built something here. And, like, why? And, you know, like, it is this kind of, like, completely fucked up version of respect.
Although you learned she didn't really jump through the hoops. She fucked Buddy Deeds and got $10,000 that he stole from the county.
Yep. So, well, you know. But that's, you know, hey, I earned this money. I fucked Matthew McConaughey. I mean, yeah.
Well, like, and also he gave it to her because sort of as a widow's grievance, because her original husband was like killed by Wade. Because he was also transporting illegals in a watermelon truck across bridges and shit. Like,
right.
And I mean, Kris Kristofferson just like outright just shoots people in the back of the head, like makes them turn. You know,
oh, yeah.
Why don't you go get me that shotgun in your truck there? And then just bam, bam.
As soon as you're touching it, boom, yeah. you're done.
And then we learn that the real guy who killed Wade back in the day was Hollis, who is now the big fat cat around town, the mayor of the town. You're kind of expecting like, oh, he's going to be like some sort of bad guy at the end of this. He's, you know, he's put mechanicians in place, you know, and he's using political stuff to like maneuver, which he kind of is, but he's a red herring basically in a way where it's, you think, oh, he's going to reveal to be like this really evil motherfucker when no, he's just this kind of bumbling cop who didn't really have the stones for it, who finds the stones there because he witnessed like a horrific murder right. committed by Wade right in front of him. And he wouldn't let another one happen.
Well, and, you know, you got to, you know, at some point you kind of make your decision, you know, like there's a gray morality to almost
yeah. all
the characters. Yeah, I killed the guy. We ended up, we buried him in the desert. Like, they found him with only his Masonic ring and his sheriff's star.
Yeah.
You find him with clothes. And so, you know, it does kind of like make me question. I mean, even after like 40 years, like if they buried the guy, like there'd be like some tatters, some clothes around him. So they strip him naked.
They probably did
bury him, but throw the sheriff's star at the mason's ring back on it, just so they can track the body in 40 years. Like there is some stuff where you kind of go like, yeah, no, there's some logic here that doesn't really make sense.
But. Maybe Wade had an extra sheriff star stuck up his ass or something.
Right.
But yeah, no. Great. This film's great.
I feel like I really didn't do it justice. I really do love the film. I do want to, you know, kind of keep revisiting it and everything. You know, it's hard to talk about because it's really good, but also kind of like there's a lot. You kind of just have to see it, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so I'm going to recommend that everybody see it. It's a, you know, rental for $3.99, purchase for $4.99 on, I think, Amazon or YouTube. And
still some Warner Brothers discs floating out there. I don't know if it's on Blu-ray. I didn't check. It probably is at this point.
Yeah, I think it was like $10 on Amazon. I just decided, I don't really care about a physical copy of it, but you know, it's easy to find.
It's one of my favorite movies of the 90s. Like, I think it's one of the, like, best movies from that decade, honestly. Yeah. Budget was $3 million. Box office, $13 million. There you go. Good modest returns.
It's an indie film in 1986, you know, mm-hmm. and not like a Tarantino clone with that. Not that I have an issue, but that's definitely the era in which, I mean, you can imagine sort of the Tarantinoized version of right.
that wouldn't play.
John Sayles would not make that version of it, you know.
No.
And again, not to criticize either, like, sort of the Tarantino clones or John Sayles, it's just saying, like, it's a very different filmmaker doing a very different kind of film, you
know? Yeah. The only little bit of trivia I want to mention is the movie playing at the drive-in that young Sam and Pilar attend is Black Mama, White Mama from 1973, which is an in-joke reference to Pilar's mixed parentage. But that movie is about a black prostitute played by Pam Grier, who hooks up with a white revolutionary and must form an uneasy alliance when they are busted out of prison and are pursued by guerrillas, bounty hunters, and the army. And Sid Haig's also in that one, too. So it's another Pam Grier, Sid Haig film from the 70s.
We'll need to add that to the list. I was really hoping it would be one of the films that John Sayles did with Roger Corman back in the day. Like, that would be, if I was John Sayles, I would totally be like, yeah, they're sitting in a movie theater watching, like, the shitty Roger Corman movie, you know, and then be like, and then there's John Sayles walking across the screen or whatever.
I mean, you would know that, like, though, Sayles obviously probably just like, hey, Roger, can I use some of that footage? You know, and he's like, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
You can pay me $8,000 under the table. Let's just do it.
$24. That's how much I need.
Yeah. I don't even know what the reel is. I'm going to have to look for it. That's
all I need for this to be profitable. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I've got reels one and three and parts of reel two. But that I didn't cut into another film that I made 3 years later. You know?
Oh my God, there are real stories of Roger Corman movies only becoming profitable like 30 years afterwards.
Oh, yeah. So
that would be something he would do. It's brilliant.
Oh, you got one of them Hollywood budgets now, you know?
Yeah.
Look at
Mr. Sayles. He's so big. Little old Roger here sitting.
I need $817 to put this film in the black. Once it's in the black, I can fund the next one. The budget for my next film is $819.
So we're doing Ghost Dog next.
Ghost Dog next, yeah, no.
Yeah, and that'll be our last little excursion into the 90s before we actually...
We go back to the black and white. So we go back.
Yeah, We're at actually, I think we're at 30 now. We're at 1930.
Oh, 30. I have to look at the list. But you know,
yeah.
We're going back to the pre Hayes Code era.
Mm-hmm.
After this, you know, like a very different kind of film. But it's been nice to step away from it for a while. But I am looking forward to getting back to our you know. I don't want to say silent, but go back to our like kind of view at the history of movies. So
yeah.
I kind of want to stick back at it until we get to. I do want to kind of like at the end of the year, kind of like let off some steam and do some fun stuff at the end of the year. But I really do want to like nose back to the grindstone and get through like the 30s by the end of the year. That's kind of my plan. So
yeah, that'll be a good goal. So Daniel, tell people where they can find you on the interwebs.
I'm on Twitter at Daniel Lee Harper. You can find my other podcast where I talk about racist fucks. You want to hear me talk more about the cold winters hypothesis? I don't think I've actually done an episode on that. I did a version of the bell curve. I think I mentioned it there. anyway, I do a podcast called Honest Speak German about racists and racism and things that racists believe. And Nazis delete their content when I mention it sometimes, and that's always hard. yeah, it's popular. People like it. So check it out. HonestSpeakGerman.libsyn.com.
Yeah. And you can find us at tmbdos.podbean.com, where you can find all of our YouTube, Facebook, and Apple Podcast links. Join the Facebook group. Best way to figure out what's coming up on the podcast and get in touch with us and communicate with us and give us suggestions and compliments and criticisms and all that good shit.
No criticisms, just compliments.
Yeah, save the criticisms for YouTube, actually. Go to our YouTube version.
Put them on YouTube and we'll misspell everything. That's the best way to do that.
Misspell it or do it in a foreign language where I have to put it through Google Translate. And yeah.
Yeah. Or just come on my Twitter and call me fat. I get that. Not a lot lately. It's funny. Like, you know.
Wow.
You're promoting genocide. Well, you're fat. Yeah. Well,
yeah. Yeah, that's way worse.
It's way worse to be fat, you know. I should read this tweet. It's hilarious. I should read this thing I got from this like dipshit. Hold on one sec. You're gonna oh god, where is it? There it is. I posted a photo of myself like frustrated with finding a new Nazi podcast I needed. And then this dipshit goes like, barely human. You could solve hunger in Africa with your fat. Make yourself useful for once. And this is literally like he thinks, you know, he thinks I give a fuck, you know. Like,
yeah,
you know? I screenshotted it just out of like ridiculousness. So you know, yeah, that's the level of bullshit that I get from my quote unquote fans.
Yeah. But anyway, thank you everyone for listening, and thank you Daniel, and we will be back next time with Ghost Dog, Way of the Samurai, which should be a lot of fun.
Looking forward to it. Cheers.
I'm blue and lonesome as a man can be. I'm blue and lonesome. Headaches over myself. My love is gone away from me. Baby, please come on back home to me. Baby, please, yeah.
Thank you for listening to They Must Be Destroyed on Sight. For further episodes, our Apple Podcasts, Facebook, and YouTube links, please go to tmbdos.podbean.com. Thank you. Drive through.